Okay, so I guess we can start. So good morning to everybody. Let's start the first session of the day. So we're glad to have Alexander Dolgov, who's going to tell us about anti-stars in the galaxy. Alexander.
Okay, thank you. I'll try to share now. So the title is Anti-Stars in Milky Way. And first page I was simply forgot to delete. And there was a kind of really astonishing announcement that maybe anti-stars in the galaxy was recently discovery of those anti-stars was recently reported. And this was the paper. Here is the reference by small group, and this is already published in Physical Review. And what they say that the title is that there is a constraint of anti-star fraction, but they say that 14 anti-star candidate were possibly found. And by some excess of gamma rays and spectrum compatible with baryon anti-baryon annihilation. It is really striking discovery because it's difficult to believe that anti-stars can be really in the galaxy. However, that existence of anti-stars was predicted more than quarter of century ago in our paper with Joe Silk and another extension of that by Kawasaki with Kawasaki, Masahiro Kawasaki, Nina Kevleshvili. And the title was Inhomogeneous Baryogenesis, Cosmic Antimatter and Dark Matter. So that there was a statement that there could be in a special model of baryogenesis, which at inflation, which leads up to very high abundance of primordial black holes. As a byproduct, it's also predicted compact objects, stellar-like object consisting of antimatter. And as for this anti-stellar kind objects, they could be either normal compact star or stars completely consisting of antimatter. The amount of those stellar kind of objects depends upon the model, and so we cannot predict absolute value. But what we did and found that there should be a population of primordial black holes with quite heavy masses, and the prediction of the model, and especially form of spectrum, which was so-called log normal spectrum. I will tell about that a little later. And the distribution, Chirp mass distribution of gravitational waves registered by LIGO, very well agrees with theoretical prediction of the model. And so it is a strong support of the scenario of this primordial black hole formation, because I repeat, log normal spectrum is pretty well agrees with what is seen. And as a byproduct, so it is a support also to byproduct of this scenario that there are some antimatter objects. Then there we stimulated by this, let's say, suggestion, rather crazy maybe. We wrote a few papers about antimatter in the Milky Way with Cosima Bambi, Sergey Blinnikov, and Konstantin Pastnov. And each star contains title antimatter and anti-star in the Milky Way. So it was not a big surprise for us, but still I repeat, then it would be really striking if this discovery is supported, is confirmed. Then it's not only black holes and anti-stars predicted and some other strange stars with unusual chemical content, quarks which may look older than the universe. There are at least one or two of such stars seen, and also very fast stars, not like pulsars, but stars which by unknown velocity, by unknown reason, moves at velocity of 500-600 kilometers per second, while normal velocity is 150 kilometers per second. Okay, so there are analysis we did, and in these three papers, and quite abundant density of compact anti-stars is not forbidden. And the point is that if we have a star, then annihilation proceeds only on the surface. It is not the same as if there is a similar amount is existed in the form of antimatter cloud. In this case, annihilation proceeds in whole volume. And so there is some suppression of annihilation exists, so that many antistars may be not seen. Okay, there was even more striking idea a year ago by Sidhu Scherer and Rob Scherer and Glenn Starkman. Antimatter, they assume that antimatter may be macroscopic dark matter. You see, then we suggested, it was, I think, first suggestion that compact with together just in compact primordial black holes could be dark matter, cosmological dark matter, but here they may proceed even further in this direction, assuming that antimatter star could be macroscopic dark matter. And I suspect that if we have that large amount of those stuff, it may be very easy to spot them than any other form of macroscopic dark matter. So I don't know at the moment if it is still viable hypothesis. But anyhow, it's maybe of interest. Okay, so there was another. Well, I would now speak about antimatter creation, and there was very recent paper 2 days ago, as I understand, June 21, by Zorab Birjani, who I hope still here. That idea is very interesting. That if there are some mirror neutron which transforms back and forth into neutron. In that case, or also it can be transformed into anti-neutron because of mirrored anti-neutron transition. And in that case, there could be antimatter inside gravitationally trapped in the stars made of mirror matter. Zorab, you will correct me if I say, well, in fact, it's a copy of the abstract of your paper. So I hope it's more or less correct. Now I come to old anti-creation mechanism, which was in our old work with Silke and Kawasaki and Kevlishvili. I repeated this title, that there could be primordial black holes, and it was after mass spectrum was really calculated in the framework of this model and happened to be of the very simple form, is the exponent of minus gamma log squared of m to certain central value m sub zero. What is interesting, we cannot, well, it is not interesting that we cannot predict value of mu squared normalization parameter and gamma. It may be natural that gamma of order of unity, but I would not bet on that. But what was possible to find that the central mass value is very close to 10 solar masses. It was the result of our paper with Konstantin Pasnov, published almost, well, let's say a year ago, slightly more. And this log normal spectrum, I repeat, is very well agrees with the data. So it may be, you would think, and central mass value is also closer, depending upon analysis. Well, it's anyhow, it is quite close to 10 solar masses, and it is related to intrinsic properties of the model, because black holes, the material for them are prepared very long ago during the inflationary stage, then corresponding bubbles, would be black holes, did not have density contrast, only high isochorology perturbations. And later on, at QCD phase transition, when quarks became massive, then they would form this chemistry perturbation turned into mass perturbation, density perturbations. And characteristic scale is of order of horizon scale at QCD. It's more or less with good precision to extend solar masses. The idea of this model is usually motivated by regenesis, proposed ages ago by Affleck and Dine. And this is very interesting model because all models of baryogenesis lead to baryon asymmetry, which is rather small, and theorists should try to do their best to make asymmetry as large as possible. In the version of Affleck and Dine, asymmetry could be of order of unity instead of 10 to minus 9 or 10 to minus 10, depending whether normalized to CMB or to entropy. And so there should be some efforts applied to diminish the asymmetry. And it is very natural in the high energy supersymmetry. There, of course, in supersymmetry, supersymmetry predicts existence of scalar field with non-zero baryonic number, and they can condense about flat direction of the potential, which is also a typical thing in Affleck and Dine model. And there could be quartic terms in the potential, which is written like that with flat directions, and terms corresponding to mass term. It is not normal. It is Hermitian potential. Usually we write mass term like m squared by absolute value of chi squared. But here we, on purpose, introduce potential which is not symmetric with respect to U1 transformation. Depending upon direction of those flat directions of those potential, there could be explicit CP violation in the model, which is also typical for this Suzy scenarios, gut Suzy scenarios. Okay, and usually after inflation, chi could be away from the origin due to rising quantum fluctuations, which were estimated by many people, Andrei Linde, Alexander Vilenkin, many other. And then when inflation is over, then mass term become essential. It would be larger than Hubble friction. And so field would go down to the position chi equals zero to in equilibrium point, according practically to the equations, which is just normal Newtonian mechanics equation. So you could easily imagine what is behavior of solution. There is liquid friction term and force. And baryonic number is simply the phase of the field. This is theta is phase of the field, and chi is absolute value. So if field start to rotate about origin, it corresponds to large baryonic number. So it can be easily done. And if, for example, direction of the valley of mass valley is not the same as the valley of quartic valley. So first field was in the flat direction corresponding to chi over to chi to the fourth power. And when it goes down, it starts to feel this quadratic flat direction started to rotate from one valley to another, gaining on the way huge angular momentum, or what is the same baryonic number. That's essentially that's the essence of the model. Okay, so our contribution with Joe Silk was we decided to introduce new interaction, which is red here. U is first term is interaction between Affleck and Dine field and inflaton field phi. It is, as it looks not very natural, but it is a general renormalizable interaction of two scalar fields. One is chi squared phi squared, another is chi squared phi, and the last one, chi squared phi one squared, is the mass term. So it's general quadratic and cubic interaction. and quartic chi squared phi squared. And so if phi during inflation reaches value phi one, this is a kind of mild fine tuning that phi one is the value of the inflaton field, magnitude of field inflaton field reached during inflation. And it means that when phi is close to phi one, windows to flat directions become open. And this potential is when phi is far from phi one, is prevent from going to flat directions. And so with rather small probability, chi may be large, and there could be bubbles with very high value of chi. And inside these bubbles, which occupy minor fraction of the universe volume, big magnitude of baryon asymmetry can be achieved. Since quarks are essentially massless, well, mass is small in comparison with the temperature. In this model, in these small bubbles, very big baryon asymmetry can be achieved. But I repeat again that density contrast would be zero till QCD phase transition. So it is evolution of this field described by diffusion equation or field chi invented first by Starobinsky, but for real field, in our case, it is complex field, but it is a trivial generalization. So that's what I essentially said, already said. So we don't need to proceed, well, to repeat it. And the only statement is, as a result, the universe look like a Swiss cheese. The difference is only that holes are high density bubbles with a very big baryonic number. Initially, they are not essential for the expansion, but right now they could be dominant part of matter, maybe dark matter. So there are quite strong limits on possible dark matter objects in different mass range, but I think it is, well, it is still possible, though mostly people believe that there could be not more than 10%, but okay. I still hope that 100% of dark matter may be in the form of dark matter, because all the limits, according to the review talk by Carr and Kuhnel, is model dependent and have their own caveats. Okay, so this is a picture which shows just numerical solution of evolution of the potential. So initially, if phi much larger than phi one, potential is quadratic rising. At some stage, it started to have additional minimum, and then it goes back to this position. So this is the picture of evolution of potential. It is a numerical solution of simple system differential equation, so it's not a big deal. And here is evolution of baryonic number. And the point is that baryonic angular momentum could be either in clockwise or anti-clockwise direction. So in one case, it is baryonic number, in other it's anti-baryonic number. These guys turned into black holes, it doesn't matter, because I don't know if this, I'm sure that it is impossible to distinguish between baryonic and anti-baryonic black holes. But if there is the parameter beta, baryon asymmetry, in fact, could be not rather small, so black holes are not formed. And in this case, we would have something like stars, or for example, it could be somewhat similar things which we study in some detail to the red giant core. And such kind of objects can be formed, and with the temperature initially, which was smaller than the temperature of surrounding matter. So cosmological evolution may be, astrophysical may be quite interesting, but what is important that rather that these stars may have quite unusual content, enriched in helium and metals, and because of that, their age, some of them could look larger than the universe age. And I repeat that these anti-stars quite probably would reach with metals, well, at least in this particular model, and also we may have high velocity and well, some other peculiar features which I already said about. Oops. So that's, I proceed maybe really fast. The results of this anti-creation mechanism is that density of what type of objects which are formed depend upon the parameter beta, baryon asymmetry. There could be primordial black holes with log normal mass spectrum, and I would stress repeating the same that indeed at least a part of populations which is seen in the universe have log normal mass spectrum. There could be stellar-like objects, like I said, cores of red giants, and also dispersed hydrogen of helium clouds with larger than average density of baryons, at least initial. And there could be quite strong bounds on these clouds if they consist of antimatter, or maybe they already, all of them already annihilated. And the last thing is compact object may be formed with negative baryon asymmetry, which is these anti-stars, which I'm, existence of which I'm trying to advocate, especially if there are support from the astronomers. So they could survive annihilation inside homogeneous baryonic background. So it's a possibility, and it's very interesting to find some other forms of their manifestation, which are we working now. And so summary, I just repeat already what I said. So abundant formations of primordial black holes took place after QCD phase transition. There could be black holes with all kinds of masses, up to 100,000 solar masses or even more. They could be seeds for more heavy black holes. Next, log normal distribution is very interesting. Another thing that peculiar features of the source of gravitational waves observed by LIGO is very nicely explained by the assumptions that these black holes are primordial. And this is quite a large part of establishment agrees with this point of view. And then there is abundant production of supermassive black holes, those masses of billion solar masses and tens billion solar masses, which take place in the very young universe, which was approximately 20 times younger than the present day universe. If you remember that standard accretion mechanism is not strong enough to explain existence of these supermassive black holes even in the present day universe, it would be even much more difficult if people would speak about creation of supermassive black holes in the universe, which was quite young, something like 500 million years. Then this may be very speculative idea, but it is not yet checked. Then there is another mystery that supermassive black holes exist not only in large galaxies, but in very small ones. Very small galaxies, and there is one supermassive black hole which exists practically in empty environment. And if it is primordial one, it's no problem. Of course, it could be some catastrophic process when two galactics collided and one of the black holes was pushed away. But anyway, to me, it seems to be quite interesting thing. This, in the this case of supermassive black holes living alone is very interesting. Then I would say that there is a large number here. It is, a large number of recently observed black holes with intermediate mass, like 100,000 solar masses or several solar masses, or even one black hole, which is observed in gravitational wave approximately with mass equal to 100 solar masses, or well, to be more precise, something 60 or 70 solar masses, which in normal, in traditional approach should not exist. But now people invent very maybe interesting possibilities, but maybe interesting to say. And I finish that a possible byproduct of this model, which at least solved many mysteries of the observation of huge amount of black holes, is possible byproduct plenty of compact anti-stars even in the galaxy and still allowed by observations. So, okay. So more data are badly needed, and that's maybe the end of the story or just beginning. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alexander, for this nice, inspiring talk. There is one question actually written, Alexander. If you can read it and reply to that, there was a written question actually in the chat, and then I see some hands.
Yeah, I was wondering. It was on slide 11.
Mm-hmm.
I was wondering why there was a log chi times the chi to the fourth.
11. This one.
Yeah. So
yeah.
Why?
This is. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that second term in the potential.
Ah, this is potential. Yeah. Okay. I should comment, but I forgot. It is a standard form of African dime theory. And this log square term is the result of one of radiative corrections, which can be summed up in one loop approximation. Assuming that chi is a constant field or slow varying, we can sum up all these diagrams, which gives logarithmic term, which is so-called Kollmann-Weinberg potential. It is, so if you look in the internet, Kollmann-Weinberg potential, you come just to this equation.
And there's just some sigma that is related to that radiative correction.
Sigma, well, it depends upon the scale, and I think it is something like, I may be wrong, but it could be, depending upon the model, it could be either electrovic scale, or but it's a logarithmic term, so it's not very important. So I'm sorry, I may forget already what is the value
I guess,
of this.
Because it just
sigma.
It would be a correction to the lambda
yeah.
one, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. So it is usual radiative corrections to massive scalar field theory having chi to the four interaction, self-interaction.
Okay. So Igor, it's your turn. You have a question, I guess.
Yes. Sasha, what should be the initial mass of anti-star at QCD or whatever when they form for it to survive? Solar masses, are they surviving? Most abundant are them solar masses, right? Do those survive or those who form later and more massive survive? What's their have you calculated this distribution?
No. Okay. I'm afraid that I cannot answer this question and feel ashamed because of that. I think we did some estimates, but since we didn't come to agreement, I maybe have to look at this paper to check.
Okay.
But Igor, it's a very good question. I'm sorry. I feel bad.
Okay, let's move to the next one. Kalpana.
I have two questions. One is that what is meant by natural baryogenesis? And another is how we can justify the antimatter as dark matter?
So let's start with the first question, which I didn't understand because there was some noise. Say it again.
What is natural baryogenesis?
What is natural baryogenesis? Well, it's difficult to say because there are a dozen of models. But the result of, there are many models which has their aim to explain only one number, ratio of baryons to entropy. Now, the baryonic density to density of entropy, or what is more or less the same, number density of baryons to number density of cosmic microwave background photons. And there are many models which are adjusted in such a way that to give the value for baryons to photons equal to 6 × 10⁻¹. So that is supposed to be natural baryogenesis, which gives this number. Maybe now the most popular thing is baryo through leptogenesis, when lepton asymmetry is generated due to very heavy Majorana neutrino, existence of Majorana neutrino, Majorana type neutrino destroy conservation of leptonic number. Then when at temperature about 10⁻¹ GeV, something like that, in the process of cooling, electrolytic processes would transform baryonic leptonic asymmetry to baryonic asymmetry, more or less in equal shares. And that's how baryon asymmetry can be generated. Now it's most popular mechanism. There are many others. And even with black hole participating in deformation, either in black hole evaporation, or recently we did some work in the black hole, asymmetric black hole capture. So there are plenty of models, and I don't know which one is natural. Okay, and please repeat your second question, please.
Second question is how we can justify the, antimatter as dark matter?
Honestly speaking, I'm rather skeptical about this model, and I wonder how we can justify it. Mean it in this, we need large amount of antistar in principle. In our model, you can obtain that, but there may be too many. These people refer to our works with Bambi, Blinnikov and Pasnov about the limits, but for me, it's most striking hypothesis I ever read. The authors, I know the authors, I mean, not personally, maybe at least, not all of them personally, but they are surely not crazy. So well, I have utmost respect to them, but I don't understand very well their construction.
Yeah, because we have to satisfy both the constraints at the same time. I mean, the presence of dark matter as well as baryon asymmetry. So both should be satisfied.
I'm not sure. You see, the point is the following. If we follow our model, then we obtain usual baryon asymmetry, I mean 10⁻¹, in the bulk of the universe. And only in small bubbles, bubbles with high baryonic density, we have huge baryon asymmetry. So these antistars, maybe, at least if I assume our model, sits in bubbles with very high baryonic number. So it has nothing to do with the standard asymmetry. What we need is just compact things. Our black holes, for example, with log normal spectrum, is bubbles with very big baryonic number, but after they became black holes, we cannot say much about their baryonic number. And these people assumed that this is a compact object, started with something with big baryonic number, but not big enough to make black hole. Big enough, you may say, density contrast at horizon scale at QCD happened to be smaller than one. So in principle, it's okay, possible. So
let's move to the next question, sorry, because there are quite a few questions. Zurab, you're next.
Yes. Sasha, I had a question. why you say that it is 500 kilometers per second, their velocities? Because they are like dark matter, they are forming outside galaxy and they are falling in. What do you assume for the masses?
I see. That what I said, I needn't assume that there are some small number of stars with very high velocity observed. And for example, pulsars with velocities of 1,000 kilometers per second are known, and the explanation of this high velocity is a slightly asymmetric collapse and emission of neutrinos in one direction to, with respect to another may give very high recoil momentum. But these stars have a velocity of, let's say, 500-600 kilometers per second, which is much larger than the average and the when the virial velocity. So I don't insist that they're our stars, but it is puzzling.
Okay,
maybe there is another explanation.
Which you say that it's predicted 500 kilometers per
second. No, it is not predicted.
It's simply just assumption.
It is not assumption, it is observation.
So
all strange things may be prescribed to that. But
that it's natural for these anti-stars to have these velocities. By Bertrand mechanism.
It is natural, I agree. But we didn't calculate, and so it is like dark matter particles.
Yeah, so they should have typical dark matter velocities.
So you're right. And for example, what is...
Because 500 is escape velocity from the galaxy, so...
Zurab, I agree, and I don't insist, I say that, what I want to say that all strange things may have something to do with a strange model.
No, sure.
That's what. And the mass, another thing...
What is the idea of the masses, how large they can be, and so on?
You see...
Most of these objects, they go to the to black holes, right?
Yes.
And so they should remain something which is light enough.
Their masses should be smaller than mass inside horizon at QCD. So it is mass of order of 10 solar masses, so they could be a few solar masses. What is maybe argument in favor of this scenario that some stars are too old. Some of them are older than galaxy, and even one of them is older than the universe. And since these stars initially consisted of, they were very much enriched by metals, and the assumption, it was not calculated, is the following, that these stars look older than they are, because what is the way how we estimated stellar age? By amount of heavy elements and calculate how much time we need for their formation. In this case, barrier of large baryonic number density, primordial nuclear synthesis proceeds much further than helium, and we did these calculations with Japanese group, and there can be even iron formed. I don't know how much we proceeded till calcium and other metals like oxygen and nitrogen. No, no. Things like
okay, that. So guys, let's move to the next question, because we have more questions actually coming. Alexander.
Yes. Okay, do you hear me?
Yes,
I do.
Yeah, it's I have a letter to say that is in your conclusion, you mentioned that log normal distribution for a primordial black holes are confirmed by observations. I think this claim is too stringent to be correct, because you know there is still no consensus that even one primordial black hole has been observed, but you said that observers, astronomers know distribution of primordial black holes. It's mm-hmm. I think it's let us see. I'm asking your comment.
What we have done together with big group in Sternberg Institute headed by Konstantin Pastov, we analyzed chirp mass distribution of LIGO event. And this is a kind of relative distribution which depends upon normalization. And in this case, it quite nicely fit log normal distribution. We, in the case of differential distribution, then there could be, one could feel that there is a mixture of log normal and astrophysical black hole populations. So at the moment, There is no consensus indeed. Well, some people say that it is proved that like events mostly are much better explained if sources are primordial black holes. There are several papers, in particular our with Blinnikov, Pastnov, and Paraika and Pastnov. Well, Pastnov, Paraika in alphabetic order, probably. So, Sasha, I agree that some problem exists, but I think that they're primordial. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
So, Peter, this is the last question. Go ahead.
Okay, probably it will be quick. Sasha, if you do a quick estimate, then the radius of a star corresponds to the horizon radius at MeV temperature, 1 to MeV. So should I conclude from that that these stars could not have been formed before nuclear synthesis, or what?
No, I don't see why it is so. Stars, stellar... density contrast appears at temperatures of 100 MeV at QCD, and some compact. You see, we have initially no density contrast, and then quarks became massive. The bubbles with high baryonic number, when quarks turned into nucleons with high baryonic asymmetry, they become massive and they look like stars. And I think if mass is smaller than horizon, then there would be.
They cannot look like stars because at the time of 100 MeV, the horizon size is much smaller than the star radius. Huh?
Okay, don't quite understand. Well,
100 times.
Horizons, well, that's a different thing. That we have. Horizon mass is about 10 solar masses.
That's correct. But yeah. The size of the horizon is smaller than the radius of a normal star.
Yes.
Okay. So it cannot be a normal star. Can be something else.
There could be, well, in fact, what we say, this would be kind of compact stars with big baryonic number density. What will be their evolution in the plasma when they initially was hotter and then they became cooler? I cannot say. Okay, let's we finished our papers saying that astrophysics of this object is not very well known.
Okay, thanks.
That I agree with your concern, and this there. Okay, thank you for the question.
Thank you, Alexander.
Ready to discuss.
Thank you, Alexander, for the nice talk. There was a lot of discussion. Actually, it was an interesting talk.